Today's episode of The Real Deal with Damian Adams is brought to you by Dat Feelin Podcast. Now, we are all chasing that feeling of righteousness, that feeling of joy, that feeling that just can't be explained. Well, the chase could be over by subscribing to Dat Feelin Podcast. Now, Dat Feelin Podcast isn't just one podcast. It's a network full of podcasts that cover everything from politics to pop culture to hip hop to movies to sports to wrestling and everything in between. So make sure you subscribe to Dat Feelin Podcast, available on all podcast platforms. Today's episode is also brought to you by the 3-point conversion. Now, the 3-point conversion is where fans' opinions matter. All right, so if you are a sports fan and you're not following the 3-point conversion, you're doing it incorrectly. The 3-point conversion has you covered on highlight videos and in-depth interviews, in-depth articles on the NBA, NFL, college football, college basketball, boxing, and everything in between. So make sure you follow the 3-point conversion on all social media platforms. Thank you for listening to The Real Deal with Damian Adams. This is real sports talk for the real sports fan. And I definitely appreciate all you real sports fans who are listening right now. If you're listening on Apple Podcasts, thank you, thank you, thank you. Do not forget to help a brother out and give me that 5-star rating, that 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That 5-star rating review would definitely be appreciated. If you're listening on the 3-point conversion station on Spreaker Radio, thank you, thank you, thank you. The 3-point conversion station is where fans' opinions matter. So please don't forget to let me know how you feel about the show. If you think the show is hot, say it loud. I think the show is hot and I'm proud. If you think the show can improve, don't say it as loudly, but please let me know. I need both your praises and your criticisms to be good at my job. Very excited about today's show. We got a lot of things to go over. NFL, a little NBA, UFC, a little everything in between. And today, I wanted to get some things off my chest, so it's no guest. It's just me and you. Just me and you. Just me and you. Ooh. Ooh, the vocals getting better. Y'all be hating sometimes, but the vocals getting better. Some people be like, oh, you can't sing. Hey, the vocals getting there, though. All right, if it's your first time listening, I'm playing. I know I can't sing. All right. But the vocals gonna get there one day. But before I get signed for a singing contract, we're gonna get this podcast off, you know, off and running. And get everybody listening so you can share it. Make sure that you tell your friends about it. But the first thing I want to get into today is the title of this episode. It's Backwards AF. And for the people out there, you know, the youngest, they know what AF means. And if you don't know, it means as fuck. Right? So I'm saying that today's episode is titled Backwards As Fuck. And you're like, dang, Damian, coming kind of rough today with the cursing and everything. What's on your mind? The reason I titled this episode Backwards AF is that I feel the world and the sports world can be backwards AF at times. And the reason I started thinking about this is with the NFL, for years now, I've been talking about how it's a passing league. You know, the quarterback is the most important position, which I do agree with, but I feel like it can be overstated on how the quarterback, it's all about the quarterback. The quarterback has to get, you know, $30 million because it's all about the quarterback. But then when we look at the teams who made the playoffs and had success, it was about running the ball. That running game is what got teams to success, with Kansas City being the exception. You're like, what you talking about, Damian? Let me break it down for you. So you look at the top rushing teams this year. Number one was Baltimore, who had Mark Ingram with over 1,000 yards, Lamar Jackson with over 1,200 yards, and also Gus Edwards with over 700 yards. That team was expected. I thought they were going to win the Super Bowl. Got upset by another team that knew how to run the rock in Tennessee. San Francisco, going to the Super Bowl, had a three-headed monster for most of this year. And in a championship game, it all went to Mostert as the main guy. But that team was second in the league in rushing at the end of the regular season, now going to the Super Bowl. Number three, Tennessee Titans. Participated in the AFC Championship game, all behind running game and defense, and had the leading rusher in the league in Derrick Henry this year. Number four was the Seattle Seahawks, who suffered because their top two running backs got hurt. Carson had over 1,200 yards, and Penny had almost 400 yards. Both of those guys got hurt. That's why they had to bring in Marshawn Lynch, who we all know is past his prime. Their running game suffered. So did the Seahawks. That's why he lost in the second round to Green Bay. The number six team in rushing, the Minnesota Vikings. We all know, as Dalvin Cook went, Minnesota went. Dalvin Cook had over 1,100 yards. You also had Madison with over 400 rushing. And without that running game, that team was not the same. Number eight, Buffalo Bills. You had Singletary over 700 yards. You had the ageless wonder in Frank Gore with almost 600. And the quarterback, Josh Allen, had over 500 yards rushing. That team improved a lot, got 10 wins for the first time this century behind defense in a running game. Number nine was the Texans. Now, we all know Deshaun Watson is unbelievable. But that team and their success was based off of running the ball. Carlos Hyde had over 1,000 yards. You had Johnson with over 400. Even Watson had over 400 yards rushing. Then at number 11 was the Eagles. So out of the top 10 rushing teams, you had 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 of the playoff teams in the top 10. Number 11 was the Eagles. 15 the Packers. 16 the Saints, who could have ran the ball a lot more. 18 the Patriots. And the only team in the bottom 10 in rushing yards that made the playoffs was Kansas City. And if you're not going to have a top 15, top 16 rushing attack, to be successful, you got to have a quarterback who's otherworldly, who's just out of this world. And that's what Kansas City has in Patrick Mahomes. So if you don't have a Patrick Mahomes, a Russell Wilson, a Deshaun Watson, you're not going to have a chance in this league if your rushing attack is in the bottom 10th of the league. You're not. But for some reason, it's all about the quarterback, which, again, is the most important position on the field, but it's not the only position. There's so many other ways to win besides just slinging the ball over the field, which is proven by those stats. So now let's look at the top passing teams. Only three of the top 10 passing teams made the playoffs, right? So Tampa Bay was up there, Atlanta, Dallas. All these teams chucking the ball over the yard had no shot at making the playoffs. Now, number five was Kansas City. Like I mentioned, they have a quarterback and wide receivers and a tight end that are unstoppable. So they can do this type of offense that is supposedly supposed to be the new offense of the day. They can do that. Not many teams can do that. Unless you have Patrick Mahomes, Aaron Rodgers in his prime, Drew Brees in his prime, players like that, Peyton Manning, those type of quarterbacks who can carry you. But that's only a very select few. But yet, you know, we're out here paying all these quarterbacks over $30 million for what? So looking at the top passing teams, the only three in the playoffs that were in the top 10, Kansas City at 5, New Orleans at 7, New England at 8. And both New Orleans and New England lost in the wild card round, due partly to their lack of running the ball, especially with New Orleans. New Orleans has the offensive line and running backs to have a better running attack. We saw that in the games where Drew Brees didn't play. Can't even say his name right. Drew Brees didn't play. Teddy Bridgewater was the quarterback, doing a great job, but they ran the ball. Latavius Murray was out here getting 20-plus carries. And imagine with that balance what happened. But for some reason, because analytics said so, you got to pass the ball more. When all I'm seeing is teams that could run the ball having success. You look at the bottom after number 20, so the bottom of the league in passing the ball. Number 21, Tennessee. In the playoffs, made the AFC Championship game. 23 Minnesota made it to the divisional round. Buffalo made it to the playoffs. Baltimore was a Super Bowl favorite going into the divisional round. So when you really look at it, why are we paying quarterbacks and receivers so much more than a running back? I understand that some of these teams that I named have running back by committees. So if you're part of a committee, you're not going to get as much, right? But the Derrick Henrys of the world, the Christian McCaffreys of the world, the Dalvin Cooks of the world, the players who can be the main guy for you deserve to get more than a star wide receiver. A star wide receiver, Michael Thomas, right? Michael Thomas broke the record for catches by a receiver. Had 149 catches. That's still going to be over 250 less touches than a star running back can get. Christian McCaffrey had over 400 touches. But he's never going to make as much as Michael Thomas, who broke the record for receptions with 149. Whose impact is more? Now, I understand you're saying that a running back doesn't last as long. Cool. Don't give the running back a long-term contract. But the money he gets per year, I'm talking the stud running backs, should be more than a star wide receiver. Looking at the salaries here, let me pull these up real quick. So Ezekiel Elliott made $15 million last year. That was the most for running back, right? Which is less than AJ Green, Jarvis Landry, Sammy Watkins, making more than Ezekiel Elliott. Like, come on, bro. Adam Thielen, Brandon Cooks, DeAndre Hopkins, you got Mike Evans, Odell Beckham Jr. All those players are great. Sammy Watkins is cool. All those other players are great. And none of those players are going to have the impact of Ezekiel Elliott, a healthy Todd Gurley, Le'Veon Bell, David Johnson. Those players who, when asked to carry the load and catch out the backfield, are getting you 300 to 400 touches. Wide receivers at max, will get you 140. And I understand that they need each other, right? The running game helps open up the passing game. Same with the passing game, opening up the running game. Understand that. But if you have a player touching the ball 400 times, he's 30% of your offense. Why is the wide receiver getting more per year? How does that make sense? We need to put respect on the running game and running backs, period. Now, I understand that a lot of people say, well, running backs come out every year. You can find a running back in the sixth round. Someone like Raheem Mostert for the San Francisco 49ers got cut 5-6 times before he finally found his spot. Alvin Kamara was a third round back, right? Yes, there are a lot of talented running backs. But there aren't a lot of this guy will carry us running backs. Christian McCaffrey's, the Ezekiel Elliott's, the healthy Todd Gurley types, Le'Veon Bell, Dalvin Cooks. Those guys do not grow on trees. But yet, they're paid as if they do. While there's tons of wide receivers out there as well. Now, true number one receivers do not grow on trees. Don't get me wrong. But that true number one receiver can be taken out of the game if you don't have a good running game. Because now, a safety doesn't have to creep in a box. A safety can just stay in the back and double DeAndre Hopkins, double Michael Thomas. Those linebackers, they can creep into the passing lanes for the slants and the end routes that the wide receivers want to run because they're no longer worried about your running game. But if your running game is strong, you do play action, which we saw with Tennessee all playoffs, now in routes, post routes, all those routes are open because linebackers, safeties, they're worried about the running back. But yet we treat, the NFL treats running backs and sports media treats running backs like they're just disposable. Which we clearly see is not the, it's not true. And we should, what's cheaper? Is it cheaper to have one stud back or three good backs? Interesting question, right? Because if you have a stud back like Ezekiel Elliott, it costs you $15 million a year. But if you have three good backs, how much are they going to cost you? Right? Somebody like a Latavius Murray is getting maybe $5 million a year. So maybe you get three backs at $5 million, one back at $15 million. But if you're getting that stud back at $15 million, now you know where you can disperse other money for other assets. Instead of spending 15 on three people, you spend 15 on one, and now you know, okay, we need to get other wide receivers or other, like, it's not so many of your 53 spots are not spent at the running back position. Like, and also this goes for quarterbacks, not just wide receivers. So looking at some of the quarterback salaries, Jared Goff, $33.5 million this year. Jared Goff was a product of Sean McVay. We all know that. Like when Jeff Fisher was Jared Goff's coach, we all thought he was a bust. Sean McVay came in, made Jared Goff look good. This year, the running game wasn't there like it was with Todd Gurley because of injuries. Jared Goff, not the same quarterback, but you're paying him $33 million because he's the quarterback. Kirk Cousins getting $28 million. The Vikings team made it to the NFC Championship game with Case Keenum at quarterback, with running the ball, having a good defense. Kirk Cousins is supposed to be that step up. They haven't made it back to the NFC Championship game. Now, it's not all on Kirk, right? Because you have sometimes offensive line isn't good. Defense may have taken a step back. But at the end of the day, you're getting $28 mil guaranteed. You're supposed to be that guy who can push them over to the top. Jimmy Garoppolo making $27.5 million. Threw the ball eight times yesterday. Eight times. But yet, running backs won't get near this much money. You know, Matthew Stafford getting $27 million a year. David Carr, getting $25 million. Drew Brees got $25 million last year. When it comes to football, every position matters so much. Why, with the quarterback position, are you able to get so much for being so average? Derek Carr is average getting you $25 million. Jameis Winston, who threw 30 interceptions, is going to be asking for more than that this offseason because he's the quarterback. Knowing if you had a legit running game and a good defense, you would ask Jameis Winston to do less. You win more. Whenever the quarterback's asked to do too much, you lose. Drew Brees' best statistical seasons have been the Saints' worst years because we're asking the quarterback to do too much. So we need to put respect on the running back position, the running game, because as you can see from all those stats that I threw at you, that's what matters. You're going to have to run the ball. And you can do it in different ways. Like with Baltimore, their quarterback is a major part of the running game. Right? You can do it in different ways. But the running game has to be there for you to be successful. Because defenses are too smart if you're just throwing the ball each and every down to not eventually stop you. Unless your talent is just that much more, like Kansas City. But that's a limited amount of right there. That's very rare to be in that rarefied air. But that ends my rant on that. We're going to take our first music break. All right? And be right back.
I'm focused, man. Tell Stout to holler at me, man. Young Hope, you heard?
New Maya! New Maya!
Jack, man, you heard? Yo! Yes! yawling. Jigga man be ballin'. Leave chicks pigeon toed. Some of them be crawling. Get the best of you whenever I put my all in. Have mommies calling for the loan. Jawling. Jigga ain't calling. Ass drop. Coops with half the top. Expose half my knot. Nigga mad when I brag about the cash I got. But I'm used to not having a lot. I'm from the gutter and I ain't the type to ever chase your box. I'm the type to interior decorate the watch. I'm the type to sling heavyweight on the block and every state I clock. Word jiggers to hurt. Holla.
Your lips are telling me yes. No, while you're just sitting on my neck, making me feel so. Should I stay? Should I go?
Bicycle since I was six. High school, the crossover, wave the way picks. Music is the same shit, gave away hits. Oh my, get it together, forget it forever. When I go at you hard, I can get it through leather. You act like Jigga can, get it whoever. Talking you got a man, okay, my and that's high school, making me chase you round for months. Having a fear, act like an adult for once. Plus my hand is up your skirt, goddamn you flirt. What's a little me on top gonna hurt? Maybe a little, but pain is pleasure and pressure bust pipes. And you look like the I like it rough type. We can crush the night. Tell me what you like. I got a yellow bottle on a bucket of ice. Get right.
Young Hofer.
DJ
Welcome back to The Real Deal with Damian Adams. Hopefully you enjoyed that music break. And now it's time for us to recap Championship Sunday. Let's start with the AFC Championship game as Kansas City defeated Tennessee 35-24. Patrick Mahomes went 23 for 35, 295 yards, or 94 yards, excuse me, three touchdowns. Also had 53 yards rushing, one rushing touchdown. Yeah, Damian Williams with 17 carries of 45 yards, 44 receiving yards. Tyreek Hill, 5 catches, 67 yards. Sammy Watkins, 7 receptions for 114 yards and a touchdown. Ryan Tannehill went 21 for 31, 209 yards, 2 TDs. Derrick Henry, 19 carries for 69 yards, 1 touchdown. Corey Davis had 5 receptions for 65 yards. Now, Tennessee started off this game great, but you know no lead is safe going against Kansas City. So Tennessee came out, got up 10-0, 17-7. And it didn't feel like with Houston. Like with Houston, when they got up 24-0, it felt flukish, right? Because Houston had to block punt for a touchdown. Tyreek Hill muffed a punt, set him up at the 6-yard line. They got an easy touchdown. So they're up 24-0, but it didn't seem real, right? Like we didn't believe you. You needed more people. Didn't quite get the curl quite right. We just didn't believe it was happening. with Tennessee, knowing what their strength is, the fact that they can run the ball, have possessions that go over 9 minutes, you figure, okay, they're up by 10. This is dangerous. But then Kansas City's defense stepped up, and they were able to pretty much, they were like, hey, Tannehill, you got to beat us. We're going to stuff this box. We're going to put six up front. We're going to go in a goal line defense pretty much, put six up front, and make you throw over us. And Tannehill has the ability to do that. But Kansas City's corners and safety, especially Tyrann Mathieu, played very well. Tyrann Mathieu was out there putting hits on people. Like, as soon as they got the ball, you heard, blacka! Because he was out there laying the wood. And with them being able to stop the run and kind of just throw Tennessee off their path, once Kansas City's offense got rolling, Tennessee didn't have a chance. And there was a big moment towards the end of the half where I put down on Twitter, Facebook, wherever, Tennessee needs to at least hold Kansas City to a field goal here. They hold them to a field goal. You got a shot. You don't want to be down with Kansas City getting the ball in the second half. And it looked like Tennessee was going to be able to hold them, right? Until Patrick Mahomes did Patrick Mahomes things, right? Tennessee, during that quarter, had a linebacker spying Patrick Mahomes, which worked for the most part because once he got outside the pocket, you saw the linebacker just barreling down on him. A few times he had to throw the ball away. Other times he had to kind of rush his throws. You saw it having some type of impact. But on this play, Patrick Mahomes got outside the pocket. You see the linebacker coming down on him. Misses the tackle. Once he missed that tackle, Mahomes takes off, gets into the end zone. Kansas City is up 21-17 going into the half. And the thing is, Kansas City didn't even score on that first possession of the second half, which really would have put it away. So when Tennessee got that stop in the first possession of the second half, I thought for sure they would have a chance in that game. Because now you get a touchdown here, you go up, you get a chance to use your running game like you've been doing all playoffs. But they never got that chance because Kansas City's defense made the adjustments. Played physical, and they were good at timing a snap. I think that's something that gets lost in defensive line play, is timing a snap. A lot of times, you know, defensive linemen will wait for the offensive lineman to react, and then when it comes to running the ball, the offensive lineman has the advantage. They get underneath defensive lineman, push them back. That's how you create the holes for the running back. But with Kansas City, looks like they were timing the snap and being able to get underneath the offensive line, close the holes for Derrick Henry. Derrick Henry didn't have anywhere to go. And usually as the game goes along, the defensive line gets more and more tired. You see them not timing the snap, offensive line getting off the ball first, getting underneath the defensive line, creating holes for running back, especially someone like Derrick Henry. You're creating holes to where once he gets rolling, being that big, now you got, you know, secondary guys trying to tackle him. And that's not fun. It's not fun being 5'10", 180, trying to tackle somebody 6'3", 250, running a 4'4". It's not fun. And I've only been in that position a few times. You know, I didn't play football that long. And, yeah, it wasn't fun. You know, I'm a great flag football cornerback. Great flag football cornerback. But tackle, not my thing. So I understand those guys who are, you know, of course, miles and miles and levels better than me, not wanting to tackle that guy. So, but what I saw in this game, man, is just that Patrick Mahomes, I've said it before and people thought I was crazy. He's the most talented quarterback I've seen. You think about the combination of arm talent with this mobility, most talented. Now, I remember a few months ago, I had the Sports Reporter Without Pay, Ray J. Lynn on. Shout out to him. Check out his Facebook page, The Sports Reporter Without Pay. He said that Peyton Manning was the most talented. Now, I have Peyton Manning as the best. I have him as the GOAT, but not the most talented because he can't move, right? And he didn't have the strongest arm. Now, his preparation was awesome. But when it comes to God-given talent, he wasn't there with Patrick Mahomes, Lamar Jackson, Michael Vick. Those guys, God-given talent is just nuts. Aaron Rodgers, God-given talent, absolutely crazy. Patrick Mahomes, there was a lot of plays during this game where a quarterback that was not mobile would not have been successful. There were so many plays where he extended the play and gave the wide receivers more time and was able to have a wide receiver change a route. And because he was able to do that, Tennessee's defense didn't have enough time to, or they had too much time to try to guard these super fast receivers that Kansas City has. And you don't know how to play it because if you blitz him, he can get free, get outside of the blitz. Now you got one-on-one with Tyreek Hill against some cornerback who's not going to keep up with him. Or if you don't blitz, you play zone and you have the defensive lineman try to contain. Now Mahomes is sitting back there all day waiting for somebody to get a hold in the zone. So I really don't know how you stop him in those receivers when he has those weapons. Because he has the arm to throw over you. He has the accuracy to throw underneath you. And he has the mobility to outrun you. It's going to be interesting to see what San Francisco does on Sunday. Or next Sunday, excuse me. Because we got the Pro Bowl in between, unfortunately. So let's get to the next game. San Francisco defeated Green Bay 37-20. Jimmy Garoppolo went 6-for-8. Yes, that's not a typo. I didn't write it down wrong. I'm not mistaken. He went 6-for-8 for 77 yards. Raheem Mostert, 29 carries, 220 yards, 4 touchdowns. For Green Bay, Aaron Rodgers went 31-for-39, 326 yards, 2 TDs, 2 picks. Aaron Jones had 12 carries for 56 yards. Devontae Adams, 9 receptions for 138 yards. Now, going into this game last week, if you are a continued supporter of the podcast, you heard me say that I don't believe Green Bay has a chance in this game. San Francisco defeated Green Bay badly in week 12, right? And I was listening to the Mina Kimes podcast featuring Lenny, and her guest mentioned that your team doesn't change that much from week 12 to now, right? If it was week one, week two, your team changes a lot from the beginning of the year to playoff time. But week 12, you are who you are at that point. We know you. Like, we know what you eat. We know your favorite foods, your favorite color. We know what your pet peeves are at this point. We know who you are. Green Bay showed us who they are against San Francisco in week 12. So I didn't get why people thought something would change. You can make some adjustments here and there, but by week 12, you are who we know you to be, unless there's injuries or something like that. And Green Bay was the healthier team going against San Francisco that day. So I saw nothing, like no hope for Green Bay, and I was completely right. And San Francisco did it in a way to where they were like, we're just going to physically dominate you. We're running the ball at you. Do something about it. Now, of course, they're very tricky and they have a way about during their plays that is not going to be something that you know exactly where it's going, because they know how to point one way, have you looking that way, next thing you know the ball's going the other way. They know how to deceive you in that way. But at the end of the day, when you run the ball that much, and your quarterback only throws the ball 8 times, that's just being more physical than the other team. You're going to have game plan that come in, and Kyle Shanahan, the head coach for the 49ers, is great at that. But throwing the ball 8 times for 77 yards and still winning in such a comfortable fashion is all about being just the better physical team at the end of the day. Man up. We're coming at you. What can you do about it? And they could do nothing. Packers could do nothing about it. And the Packers defense, it's weird because the Packers made it to the NFC Championship game. So obviously they're a good team. But I felt like they got a few breaks here and there that led to them getting this opportunity. during the regular season, their schedule was a little weak. You got games against Detroit, Chicago, who went down this year. And Minnesota was good, but you know once you stop Dalvin Cook, what's going to happen with Kirk Cousins. And they didn't really have tough games until the end. Then come playoff time, they get a bye because of the tiebreaker with the Saints, which had a big impact because the Saints had to play in the first round and lost. So now you get that bye. You face Seattle, who's coming in without their running backs. Seattle's defense is not the same as it was in its heyday. You beat them in a game that's very competitive. Like, it wasn't like they blew Seattle out of the water. Game that's very competitive. Then you get to a game against San Francisco. And we saw what happened. Just pure dominance by San Francisco. And Jimmy G, the man who made almost $30 million this year, threw the ball 8 times. Which goes back to my backwards AF point at the beginning of the podcast. When it's time for most start to get paid, they're going to say, oh, he was part of a committee. Even though in the most important game of the year, he was the bell cow back. The guy that you gave the ball to 29 times, who got you over 200 yards and carried you to victory. Now, the defense, of course, is a major part of that. But offensively, he carried you. But Jimmy G's getting $30 million a year because he's the quarterback. Come on, man. Not going to get into the Super Bowl this week. I want to bring on a guest next week, a special guest, to break down in depth the Super Bowl next week, position by position. For guys who have been listening for a long time, you know how we do it. We go literally quarterback, running backs, wide receivers, offensive line, defense line, linebackers, cornerbacks. We do the whole thing position by position, break it down, then give our predictions. But I do think this is going to be a great matchup of top offense versus top defense. I'm really, really looking forward to it. Congratulations to both the Kansas City fans and the San Francisco 49ers fans. We're going to take our next music break and be right back.
Told him up, light it up, nigga. Birdman, motherfucker. Clipse. Ain't no nigga. But you smell, money smell.
Cobra leaf plant.
Slash straight off the border, yo, motherfucker.
Come on, little one, handle your business for me, boy.
What happened to that boy?
Yeah.
What happened to that boy? What happened to that boy? He was talking shit, we put a clap into that boy. What happened to that boy? What happened to that boy? What happened to that boy? He was talking shit, we put a clap into that boy.
I heard he snitching on a player, man, say it ain't so. Even as a youngin', they consigned me to blow. Which explains why I'm worth my weight in gold. While they was taking baby steps from an eighth to an O. Word in the streets that the envy is me. Enough ice on that watch to make a nigga lose sleep. Magnified face, help the bitch see clearly. 9 on the waist, hit the bitch up severely. I'm known for the flip of that cocaina. I'm heavy in the street like the 7-series Beamer, man. Hit him with the Nina, man. Or that 4-5 guaranteed to lean your man. Whoa, I'm the reason that your block is vacant. Malicious will hit ya just to make a statement, bitch. Clips and cash money, who ain't rich? Don't compare me to you, nigga. You ain't this. Whoa.
What happened to that boy? What happened to that boy? What happened to that boy? He was talking shit, we put a clap into that boy. What happened to that boy? What happened to that boy? What happened to that boy? He was talking shit, we put a clap into that boy.
Stunner and patty cake, the worldwide push.
Birdman, nigga, leave the guns in the bushes. Bitch, getting up freaks.
Let him unload them to gusty. Balls are together with the round shape cooking shit. One throw, one nigga, flood the block. If I don't go to jail, niggas, birds gon' flock. Niggas sitting on the turlet, bitch, get off the pot. The bird just landed, so the hood gon' rock. New whips, big chips, the Prada Gucci shit. But mommy, your fly beans, the wide skinny lips. She takes my flight, she holds my weight. While the pork was staked out from state to state. It ain't nothing to a baller, baby. Pay the cost, big money, heavyweight, Birdman, hood boss, baby. Stepping on my line, I show a little something. May call it young, come out in the black crawl, touch.
What happened to that boy? What happened to that boy? What happened to that boy? He was talking shit, we put a clap into that boy. happened to that boy? What happened to that boy? What happened to that boy? People talking shit, we put a clap into that boy. Another soul lost, had to make his shirt match my ox blood colored Porsche. The rims match, of course. Blood hit his Timbs, it reminded me of them. Glistening, wrist on chiller. Gun in the same palm, a gorgeous killer. I put this on my lord. My niece was four when she felt chinchilla. I passed the shore for that shit that made fiends rise from the dead like Thriller. Gangster, hustler, at night still found time to kiss my mother. Live like I'm dreaming, kick my feet up. Gun poke my waist, remind me of my demons. So quit your yapping before I get to clapping and have your body parts mix and matching, fella. What happened to that boy? What happened to that boy? What happened to that boy? People talking shit, we put a clap into that boy. What happened to that boy? What happened to that boy? What happened to that boy? People talking shit, we put a clap into that boy.
Hey, there it is, nigga, that you have. Birdman, Clipse, Young Smith, VA, you know. Uptown, nigga, uptown. We go anywhere with this bullshit. We full of bricks, you understand? Hey, nigga, put this puzzle together. Hey, for real, you did this shit, nigga. 1,000 pieces, puzzles, Star Trek, you know, let's get this money. Hey, nigga, I smell something. Cocoa leaf plants, bitch, you know. Get money, motherfucker. However you want it, you can get it, pimp. From gangster to blood, nigga, take it how you want it. Nigga, we get it how we live. Ain't nothing but the thug thing, nigga. Money thing, motherfucker.
Welcome back to The Real Deal with Damian Adams. Hopefully you enjoyed that music break. So now I wanted to get into a few topics before the last music break in Forgotten Player. So let's talk about Odell Beckham Jr. Now LSU defeated Clemson this past Monday night for the College Football National Championship. Go Tigers! And Odell Beckham Jr. was out there acting a fool, right? And I was listening to the Joe Budden podcast earlier. I'm a big fan of the podcast. And Rory was on there saying that Odell was just having fun and that he's Odell, so there's going to be cameras everywhere catching everything. Yes, that's correct. And Odell wasn't the only celebrity on the sideline. Tyrann Mathieu was there. Ryan Clark was there. Booger McFarland, all the LSU alumni of past and present were there. None of them were caught yelling to a microphone in front of a security guard's face when he's trying to take the microphone away or the megaphone. None of them were caught doing the most with Karl Malone and posting Karl Malone up, dunking on Karl Malone on the sideline. None of them were caught handing out cash to players on the field. None of them were caught slapping the butt of a security guard who was just trying to do their job in the locker room. Odell Beckham made this about Odell Beckham by doing too much. Now, Odell Beckham handing out cash to the players has led to a bigger discussion about how it's not right that that's a big thing. He should be able to give cash to those guys without it being a big deal. I get it. I agree. He should be able to give those guys cash because they just made LSU millions upon millions upon millions of dollars, not billions. Right? So they deserve a piece of the pie. So I have no problem with him giving them money. But why not do it in private? Why not give it to them through Venmo, through Cash App, through Zelle, through PayPal? There's so many different ways you could have given them money. Or if you have to give them cash, why not just wait until there's no cameras around? Hey, bruh. See, he comes on the sideline. He says, hey, good game. Hey, I got something for you later. Just wait till the camera's not around. I got you. That player's not going to forget that. He's going to be like, oh, I wonder what Odell got for me. Odell can give him the cash then. And some people were saying that it was a protest of how college players are treated. Which, again, I believe college players should get paid. The way I would do it is that you set up a fund. You give them a stipend, like they have enough money to be comfortable when they're playing. Like if you give them, if they live in off campus, you give them like $2,000 a month to make sure they got enough to pay for rent and be comfortable. They live in on campus, maybe a little less than that because they're not paying any rent, right? But enough to eat, enough to take a girl out to a good meal, whatever, make sure they're good, which some college athletes do get. My girl played in college. She could talk better to that than I did because I didn't play in college, right? But for you to give out cash on the field right after the national championship game, you know a million cameras are around, and you know that you're Odell Beckham Jr. So you know cameras are going to follow you wherever you go on that field. And you're going to try to act like you're doing it on the sly. Oh, I'm dapping you up with the cash in my hand. Like, we're not going to see it. And again, I'm with you on college players should get paid. Right? Because the fact that Coach O for LSU and Coach for Clemson got $1 million bonuses for making it to this game and the players aren't seeing anything is wrong. I agree. But again, PayPal, Venmo, Zelle, Cash App, so many different ways. Or give cash when cameras are not around. It's not that hard to not make it about you. It's not that hard. Like, it's very easy to do a good thing, like give these players money in private. I believe it's very easy to do that. But for some reason, he's not capable of not being the topic, of not being a center of attention. And for me, I root for everybody coming out of New Orleans. Being somebody from Morrell, Louisiana, which is 10 minutes outside of New Orleans, I root for everybody coming out of New Orleans to do well. So when Odell Beckham came on the scene with the hair, the one-hand catches, I was so happy to see it. But now, your talent is overshadowed by the fact that you got to wear a $250,000 watch on the field. The fact that when you don't get, your team isn't doing well, you're on the sideline yelling at the coach. You're kicking nets. You're doing too much. You're on a yacht the week before the playoff game. Come out for the playoff game when you're with the Giants and lay a dud. You're doing too much. Being backwards AF. Like, it was so much. Like, and I understand he was drunk. Or high. I'm going to say drunk because I'm not going to say that he was out there doing anything that he would get popped for in the NFL test. He's allowed to drink. He's over 21. He's allowed to have a good time. Right? But everybody else had a good time without getting warrants, without being issued warrants for their arrest, without having all the attention on them for doing things like giving cash to the players. So I have to disagree with my man Rory from the Joe Budden podcast. He was having fun, but he also was making it about him. And it doesn't have to be about you, bro. It doesn't. You can do those things that you wanted to do and just be Odell. Be one of the LSU alumni. You don't have to be the LSU alumni out there. And that's my spell on Odell. So he had a big UFC matchup this weekend as Conor McGregor defeated Cowboy in 40 seconds in the first round, very quickly. Soon as the bell rung, McGregor pretty much just sprinted across, came with a big left hand, which Cowboy was able to slip the left, but then they got in close, they got tied up, and Conor McGregor hit him with these nasty shoulder shots to the face, which broke his nose. And then after the shoulder shots, Cowboy tried to come back with a kick, which was blocked by McGregor. McGregor then hesitated a little bit, then throw a kick, caught Cowboy clean. Cowboy fell down from the kick. McGregor jumped on top of him. Boom, boom, boom. The referee tried to give Cowboy every chance to get up because I think most fighters would have got stopped a little earlier. But McGregor just pounded on him, pounding on him, pounding on him. And Herb didn't even have to stop it. He had to. So, of course, after a performance like that, with McGregor being such a big draw, the question is going to be what's next, right? And one thing I do not want to see, repeat, do not want to see, is McGregor versus Mayweather 2. I'm not here for that. I'm not paying for it. I'm going to try to stop my friends from getting it. Like, if Floyd Mayweather truly wants to come back this year and truly wants to say, I'm going to box a boxer. Mayweather, you're arguably the greatest of all time. Why? Like, it's frustrating to me because I am a boxing fan. I'm somebody who loves the sport. And Mayweather, despite if you like his antics or not, is one of the best to ever do it. So why the spectacles? I understand the first time against McGregor. I get it. That was going to make money. And, you know, it makes sense. The second time with McGregor, no. I'm telling people not to do it. If they go off and they try to do another one of these Mayweather versus McGregor fights, don't buy it. Don't do it. Mayweather, if you want to truly be back, give one of these young guys a shot at you. If you truly back, if you truly still believe you're the best, go fight an Errol Spence Jr. Go fight a Terrence Crawford. Go fight Sean Porter, Keith Thurman. Shit, even Danny Garcia or somebody like that. Somebody in the welterweight division. Or go up to 160, fight Canelo again. Give him another shot, since Canelo right now could be the best in the game. Fight at 154 and give the Charlo brother a chance that fights at 154. Fight somebody who really has a shot, who can really box. Even at this point, if you did fight Pacquiao again, that would be better than McGregor. Don't do McGregor. Even though I don't want to see Pacquiao again either, but that's the better option out of those two. But fight somebody new. You truly trying to come back and catch boxing fans' interest? Don't just make a spectacle. Make a real fight. Take a chance, Mayweather. I'm challenging you, Floyd. And I know Floyd's not listening to me, but if somebody who knows Floyd is listening to this podcast, tell him I said it. Fight somebody who can really give you a fight, Floyd. Or don't come back. Like, you submitted your legacy. You're good. 50-0. You can ink it in gold, as Cam Newton would say. You're good to go. But if you're going to come back, make it for real. I'm, for one, not paying to see Mayweather McGregor 2. You shouldn't either. Don't do it. Also, just going back to that UFC card, I'm not a UFC expert in any way. But I felt disappointed by the card. The Holly Holm fight was very boring. They just was tied up the whole time. And people kind of get on me for saying that because they're like, oh, you don't understand the technique of it. And I'm somebody who can appreciate a Floyd Mayweather in boxing. But in boxing, even if you have somebody like Floyd Mayweather who's not going to knock you out, you still see the technique of him making you miss, of him hitting you 4 or 5 times in a row. You still see the action. With a UFC fight, you have somebody who's great at grappling and they're not on the ground, or they're so good that the other person has no chance when it comes to that certain aspect of it. Like Holly Holm literally just pinned a girl against the cage the whole fight, gave her some knees, a couple elbows, and won. And it was great. She won, but she knew it was a boring fight. She apologized afterwards. So don't act like I'm crazy for saying that that's not entertaining, when the fighter herself apologized for that. With UFC, when it comes to when they're in the grapple, if there's not a lot of action going on, do like boxing. Break it up. Say, hey, we need you to fight. That's what we're here to see. That's what people paid to see. You fight, not you just hold each other and sit there and hug. But like I said, people, I'm not a UFC expert. I'm not an MMA guy in that way. I'm more of a boxing guy. And I understand that some people can say boxing can be boring. There can be boring boxing fights. But even with a technician, you see the technical ability at work. With a UFC technician, sometimes you don't get to enjoy the technical work that's being done because they're just holding each other the whole time. And I felt like there was no fight that really stood out as like, oh man, that was awesome. That was great. You know, you had to fight with the heavyweights with an old Russian dude, beat the black dude, made him tap. That one was okay. But this card as a whole wasn't really, like, McGregor knockout kind of made it worth it because of how spectacular and explosive it was. But as a whole, I feel like the card was kind of disappointing. But maybe I'm wrong. Let me know if you're an MMA guy, how I was wrong about that take. So you guys, if you know, I've said during this show, I'm originally from Louisiana, big Saints fan and a big Pelicans fan, right? And on Wednesday, January 22nd, we have the return of Zion! Yes, as you could tell, I'm very excited about it. Zion Williamson is making his debut against the San Antonio Spurs on Wednesday for the Pelicans. And what does this mean for the Pelicans, right? Because currently right now, they're 3 games behind Memphis in the win column. They just beat Memphis today on Martin Luther King Day. Shout out to Drew Holiday, who hit 7 threes in that game. So, and the Grizzlies had been on a crazy roll, had 7 wins in a row before that game today. And the Pelicans beat them. The Pelicans have been playing good lately. The return of Zion may be able to push the Pelicans into the playoff race. When you look at the bottom of the Western Conference with Oklahoma City, Memphis right there, New Orleans is not too far behind those guys. With the teams in between, the teams fighting there with Phoenix and all those guys, Sacramento. Zion, if he is what we expect him to be, I understand there's going to be a minutes limit. He's not going to be able to go full force right away. But if he's the guy who can get you 20 points, 8-9 rebounds, or even if he's getting you 15-8, 5 assists, with the way that Brandon Ingram is playing at an all-star level, Drew Holiday, great 2-way player, Josh Hart coming off the bench, the way they've been playing lately, the Pelicans could make a playoff run with Zion coming back. Zion is done with Rookie of the Year. Ja Morant's got that pretty much locked up. But I just want to see how he comes back, how he's implemented into the offense, how he runs away down the floor. With a fast-paced team like the Pelicans, does he hold up throughout the rest of the year? I'm very excited to see what happens. Can't wait for the game on Wednesday. I'm coming home right to the TV, right to the League Pass, putting it on. And now we're going to take our last music break and be back with the end of the show.
Fucking posers.
It's too damn late to apologize. When you see the mess of
past, about to get it off. Let me know what left when we shut it off. We ain't gonna take it no more, cause it's almost over now. Almost over now.
Jesus, better get it off. Yeah, let's let it go.
Look, it's almost over now. Almost over now.
You don't succeed cause you hesitate. You think we're flying. Just be yourself. Don't ask us why. Cause if you don't,
can't hear me, I'm a rock star. I'm running on the top of a cop's car. I'm a rebel in my four-pole pop star.
It's almost over now, almost over now.
I guess you ain't heard that we still got. It's too damn late to apologize. When you see the mantle and when you see the sky.
It's almost over now, almost over now. You think that you don't have to ever quit. You think that you can get away with it. You think the light won't be ever lit. It's almost over now, almost over now. Stuck them on your chest, better get it off. Let me know what left when we shut it off. We ain't gonna take it no more. Cause it's almost over now, almost over now.
You can't be me, I'm a rock star. I'm rhyming on the top of a car car. I'm a rebel in my 4-4 pop star.
It's almost over now, it's almost over now.
I guess you ain't heard that we still got. It's too damn late to apologize. When you see the mantle or when you see the sky.
It's almost over now, almost over now.
No one ever really dies. Do you believe that? Well, if not for you,
it's almost over now, almost over now.
Welcome back to The Real Deal with Damian Adams. Hopefully you enjoyed that music break. And now it's time for us to end the show. And if you are a continuous supporter, you know how we end the show. We do a forgotten player, and then I get out of here, right? So my forgotten player today, this is forgotten players is where we pay homage to players who may have been good, but not great, great, but not recognized, or players who you may have just forgotten about who we want to remind you of. So my forgotten player today is London Fletcher. London Fletcher was a linebacker, 5'10", played 16 seasons in the NFL for the Rams, Bills, and Washington. Fletcher played at his best during his mid to late 30s, right? Which is weird for the NFL player, especially during that time, to get better during those years. But he made the Pro Bowl every year from 2009 to 2012 while playing for Washington. And that was when he was 34 to 37 years old, which is nuts. To playing at a Pro Bowl level at linebacker at that age during those years. Something that you definitely got to respect. He led the league in total tackles in 2011. He ended his career with 2,039 total tackles, 109 tackles for loss, 23 interceptions, and 96 passes defended. When you think about players like that, man, who just grind, get better, and were able to play at a high elite level into their late 30s, you just got to respect the grind that it takes. I know that, you know, a lot of it is just physical gifts as well, but you have to work. You know, there's been a lot of physically gifted players who didn't last long, who didn't live up to their potential because they weren't able to put that work in or weren't willing to put that work in. With somebody like a London Fletcher, you saw him put that work in and for it to pay off. He's a Super Bowl champion, you know, somebody who truly is a player's player. So big shout out to London Fletcher as my forgotten player today. And I want to give a big shout out to you guys, man, for supporting the show. I know I ask a lot of you when I hit you up to share the show or say, man, you know, just tell your friends about it, but please help. You know, I definitely appreciate it. I want to be able to grow this show as much as possible, and I need your help to do that. So please continue to share, talk about, listen to this show, and give your feedback. Give your feedback on Apple Podcasts, right? If you listen to this on Apple Podcasts, you go to rate the show. Give it 5 stars, please. I would really appreciate that. And let me know what you think of the show. You know, if you have less than stellar reviews, don't share it on air, you know. Tell me in private that you think the show can improve in this way or that way, and I will take that into consideration. You know, I know some people like the shows more with guests. Some people like it more when I'm by myself because I can just do these rants like I'm doing right now. That's why I like to give a little bit of everything, right? I can do the interviews like I did last week with Renee P. Washington. I can do the rants like I'm doing today. I can go with, you know, a football player like Jerry Porter and have him on the show. Very versatile in this show, man. I just have enjoyed the growth that I've been able to make and hope to continue growing with you and with more fans coming because of you. So please continue to support The Real Deal with Damian Adams. Follow me on all social media platforms at The Real Deal WDA. And until next time, go real or go home.